Daniel chapter 9 verses 4 to 19. I prayed to the Lord my God and made confession saying, O Lord, the great and awesome God, who keeps covenant and steadfast love with those who love him and keep his commandments, we have sinned and done wrong and acted wickedly and rebelled, turning aside from your commandments and rules. We have not listened to your servants, the prophets, who spoke in your name to our kings, our princes, and our fathers, and to all the people of the land. To you, O Lord, belongs righteousness, but to us open shame, as at this day to the men of Judah, to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and to all Israel, those who are near and those who are far away, in all the lands to which you have driven them because of the treachery that they have committed against you. To us, O Lord, belongs open shame, to our kings, to our princes, and to our fathers, because we have sinned against you. To the Lord our God belong mercy and forgiveness, for we have rebelled against him and have not obeyed the voice of the Lord our God by walking in his laws, which he set before us by his servants and the prophets. All Israel has transgressed your law and turned aside, refusing to obey your voice. And the curse and oath that are written in the law of Moses, the servant of God, have been poured out upon us because we have sinned against him. He has confirmed his words, which he spoke against us and against our rulers who ruled us, by bringing upon us a great calamity. For under the old heaven there has not been done anything like what has been done against Jerusalem. As it is written in the law of Moses, all this calamity has come upon us, yet we have not entreated the favor of the Lord our God, turning from our iniquities and gaining insight by your truth. Therefore, the Lord has kept ready the calamity and has brought it upon us, for the Lord our God is righteous in all the works that he has done, and we have not obeyed his voice. And now, O Lord our God, who brought your people out of the land of Egypt with a mighty hand and have made a name for yourself, as at this day we have sinned, we have done wickedly. O Lord, according to all your righteous acts, let your anger and your wrath turn away from your city Jerusalem, your holy hill, because of our sins and for the iniquities of our fathers. Jerusalem and your people have become a byword among all who around us. Now therefore, O our God, listen to the prayer of your servant and to his pleas for mercy, and for your own sake, O Lord, make your face to shine upon your sanctuary which is desolate. O my God, incline your ear and hear. Open your eyes and see our desolations and the city that is called by your name. For we do not present our pleas before you because of our righteousness, but because of your great mercy. O Lord, hear. O Lord, forgive. O Lord, pay attention and act. Delay not for your own sake, O my God, because your city and your people are called by your name. This is the word of the Lord.
The New Testament reading is taken from the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 1, verse 18 to 25. For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. For the Jews demand signs, and the Greeks seek wisdom. For we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and folly to Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. This is the word of the Lord.
May I invite you all to stand to sing the gradual hymn, Jesus Paid It All. The gospel reading this morning is from the book of St. John, chapter 2, verses 13 to 22. All glory to Christ, our Savior. Verse 13. The Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple he found those who were selling oxen and sheep and pigeons and the money changers sitting there, and making a whip of cords, he drove them all out of the temple, with the sheep and oxen, and he poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned the tables. And he told those who sold the pigeons, take these things away. Do not make my Father's house a house of trade. His disciples remembered that it was written, zeal for your house will consume me. So the Jews said to him, what sign do you show us for doing these things? Jesus answered them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. The Jews then said, it has taken 46 years to build this temple, and will you raise it up in 3 days? But he was speaking about the temple of his body. When therefore he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. This is the gospel of Christ. Praise to Christ our Lord.
Good morning, please be seated. This morning, we have a guest speaker, Pastor Timothy Yeo. He hails from Singapore, Evangelical Free Church, and he's been here a couple of days now doing the mentoring training that we are embarking on, the initiative to give us a do's and don'ts so that we know what to do as we begin to start a mentoring process. Not a program, but a process in the church. So let's give him a hand as he comes and bring the word of God to us.
Thank you, Bishop. Good morning. It's a joy to be back in the Anglican Church. I grew up in the Anglican school, and it happened to also be called St. Andrew's. So it feels like a home away from home, if you like. So it's so good to see different ones of you. It's a joy to have met some of you over the weekend. I was telling Bishop Andy that he has such a wonderful group of people here who loves the Lord and serves Him with all their heart. Amen. So once again, good morning. I'm going to begin our time together with a question that hopefully will help frame our time together. Let me get my slides out. Okay. And the question is this: what keeps you anchored when the storms in life hit you? What keeps you anchored when the storms in life hit you? For some of you here, you are already retired. When you encounter an illness due to old age, how would you respond? What keeps you anchored when the health report that you have isn't as what you expected? Or for some who are slightly younger, I understand from some of them that they like to take weekend trips to Miri, to Singapore for the weekend just to unwind, because sometimes life gets so busy, gets so stressful, they need a break. Or for some, it could be parents who have kids, and you are so caught up with taking care of your kids or your grandkids that you rarely had time to spend with your spouse. And maybe it could be regular date nights with your husband or your wife so that you can reconnect and you can rekindle the love for each other. What keeps you anchored when the storms in life hit you? This morning, we're going to learn from Daniel, which many of us are familiar with. Daniel, who is no stranger to storms in his life. And we're going to learn what keeps him anchored when the storms of life hits him. But before we continue, let me pray for us. Eternal God and Heavenly Father, we come before You, grateful that we have the freedom to worship You. And now would You come, remove every distraction in our midst. Holy Spirit, come and would You illuminate our minds, convict our hearts. And may the Word of God this morning take root in our life and bear fruit for You and Your glory. We give You praise in Jesus' name. Amen. And so as we look at the storms in life, I titled this morning's sermon as Anchored Through the Storm. Anchored Through the Storm. Turn to someone next to you and say, are you ready? Are you ready? We're going to look at the prayer of Daniel this morning, Daniel 9, where we get a glimpse of what Daniel prays for as he goes through the time in Babylon. Now, before we dive into Daniel 9, it's important for us as we read any text that we know and understand the background and the context before we dive into any passage of Scripture that we read. So I want to give us a brief context of the book of Daniel. Daniel was written and situated in a time period where the people of God were in exile. They were in exile because of their disobedience and their waywardness. And as a result of breaking the covenant that they had with God, God allowed their neighboring empire, the Babylonian Empire, to conquer their land. And as a result, they were now in exile. So that's where the people of God were when the book of Daniel is written. And Daniel was basically the one representing the people of God throughout the whole book of Daniel. From Daniel chapter 1, if you look with me in your Bibles real quick, Daniel chapter 1, you'll see Daniel entering exile as a teenager, 17, 18 years old. He was a teenager when he entered, and like many of people here in Brunei, they all want to serve the government. A lot of them, they want to serve the government, right? Because they love their country. And so Daniel was one of the few that was selected to be a scholar. And he went through a three-year process of knowing the culture of Babylon, understanding the DNA, so that he can serve in the king's court as an official. So that was where Daniel began his journey, in the king's court. But right in the beginning, you will see throughout the book of Daniel that he experienced time and time again different storms in his life that tested his faith. And through those storms, we're going to learn something that is a common thread in Daniel's life. What was the common thread that helped him to be anchored through the storm? I want to give us a quick example before we dive into Daniel 9 to show us the point. For example, in Daniel chapter 6, it's a time period where Daniel has risen through the ranks from being an intern, if you like, in the Babylonian Empire. Now, in Daniel chapter 6, Daniel is already a senior official, one of the highest ranking officials in the king's court. And his colleagues, the other high officials, they didn't like him. And so they tried to find ways to get Daniel, to try to find fault, try to find criminal things on Daniel. But the Bible tells us in Daniel chapter 6, verse 4, that they can't seem to find any fault with Daniel. That's what it says here in verse 4. They find no ground of complaint or any fault. And so the high officials had no choice. In Daniel 6, what they did in the end was this. They only could find fault by his faith. The religion was the only thing that they could find fault with Daniel. And so they came up with a very cunning scheme. A cunning scheme that basically asked the king, okay, now, from now on, no one is allowed to worship any other gods besides the king. They knew that because they for sure knew that Daniel was going to worship his own God, Yahweh. And so they came up with this decree to catch Daniel. And I want us to notice real quick, what was Daniel's response when he encountered this particular storm in his life? Now, before I go into that, I want to quickly share with you a quote from Martin Luther. It says, "To be a Christian without prayer is no more possible than to be alive without breathing." I thought this quote is quite apt for us as we think about our own walk with God. On where does prayer play in our own lives? Is it true for us as well that prayer is integral in our own Christian walk? Because that's what Martin Luther said, the great reformer. But back to Daniel chapter 6, I want you to notice what he says here in Daniel chapter 6, verse 10. Upon receiving the news, he says here, "Now when Daniel learned that the decree had been published, he went home to his upstairs room where the windows opened towards Jerusalem. Three times a day, he got down on his knees and prayed, giving thanks to his God, just as he had done before. There are two things I want us to note over here in this particular verse. The first is this. You recognize that the first thing that Daniel did upon receiving a news that is coming his way, that is not so good news. What does Daniel do? The first thing that he did in verse 10, it shows us he went up to his room. And what did he do? He got down on his knees and prayed. Prayer was not a last resort. Daniel didn't go and try, okay, let me see how I can work around this new decree that was given so that I can continue to pray. No, Daniel went straight and he brought it before the Lord. Prayer was his first resort. It was his first resort. But not just that. I want you to take note of the phrase I highlighted at the end. He says, just as he had done before. Not only is prayer Daniel's first resort, prayer was something that Daniel did week in, day out. Regardless of whether it's a high in his life or a low in his life, prayer was something that he did 3 times a day, every single day, regularly. That prayer is integral. Prayer is integral to the life of Daniel that keeps him anchored through the storms in life. And so that's where we're at in Daniel chapter 9 now. At Daniel chapter 9, Daniel has go further on in his life. He is now about in his late 80s. So he has served the king for many years faithfully in a foreign land. And now Daniel, in his late 80s, we read in Daniel chapter 9, verse 1, that Daniel is now under a new empire. The Babylonian Empire have been conquered. Now a new empire came in. It's the Medo-Persian Empire. And Daniel lives under the new empire, according to Daniel 9, verse 1. And we see that in Daniel chapter 9, verse 1, that Daniel was in the process and doing what he always does. What was it? Praying. Daniel was praying. And when he was praying, he was also reading the scriptures as he prayed. And he was reading through Jeremiah, according to Daniel 9, verse 2. He was reading through the book of Jeremiah, and specifically Jeremiah 25. Jeremiah 25. Why do we say that? Because Daniel talked about how there will be the end of the desolation of Jerusalem, namely 70 years. Now, when you talk about this desolation, when the people of God were in exile for 70 years, when you look at Jeremiah 25, verse 11, you will see Jeremiah 25, verse 11 talking about how Israel or the people of God will be in exile for 70 years. So Jeremiah was likely reading Jeremiah 25 as he was praying. And as he did that, one of the things that he highlighted was this. He was not just praying, but one of the things that he did as he prayed towards God was this. In verse 3, it tells us that he was praying and pleading for mercy with fasting and sackcloth and ashes. This was what kind of shaped the prayer. And the idea of fasting, of putting on sackcloth and ashes, is this idea of coming before God in humility, coming before God in remorse and in repentance. That was the context of Daniel's posture as he prayed. So this morning, we're going to learn two essential ingredients from the life, from the prayer of Daniel, on how can we pray through the storms in life. The first thing that we come to learn from Daniel, from verses 4 to 14, is that the repentance of our nature is something that Daniel prayed for in his prayer. Repentance of our nature. As I mentioned earlier, Daniel began his time and his posture of praying with fasting, sackcloth, as a posture of repentance and remorse. Now, here's the thing for us to note. Why was Daniel in sackcloth, fasting, and repenting? if you look through the context of Jeremiah 25, the prophet Jeremiah prophesied a time where the people of God will go into a time of exile because they have broken the covenant. They have not kept their end of the covenant. And as such, God will allow the Babylonian Empire, according to the prophecy in Jeremiah, for the people of God to be in exile for 70 years. Now, as I mentioned earlier, when Daniel started in Daniel chapter 1, how old was he? He was 17, 18 years old. And now in Daniel chapter 9, he's about in his late 80s. What does that mean? They were actually living, the people of God were living in the exile that Jeremiah talked about, but more importantly, the people of God were actually near the end of their exile. You make a calculation, 80s, 17, 18, close to 70 years. The people of God were near the end of their exile in Babylon, according to the prophet Jeremiah. But instead of saying, okay, let me go get ready to pack my clothes or whatever I have so that I'm ready to leave at the 70-year mark. No, Daniel didn't do that. Instead, Daniel, what did Daniel do after reading the prophecy that he's living in? Daniel went on his knees and he started to pray. Why? Because Daniel was brought to mind the very reason why the people of God were sent into exile. And the reason was because they were disobedient. They have sinned. They have broken the covenant with God. That was the reason why they were in exile in the first place. And so that's why Daniel went on his knees and started to pray to God. We see that here, as I mentioned, in verse 3, in fasting and sackcloth and ashes. Now, as you look at Daniel chapter 9, 4 to 14, if you take your Bibles out with me and you follow along, because I'm not going to go through every passage of the scripture, but if you follow along with me from 4 to 14 in Daniel chapter 9, as you read through and you scan through real quick, you will come to realize that Daniel is describing the people of God in their disobedience, how they have sinned, how they have disobeyed God. And in chapter 9, verse 11, he talks about this. He says, therefore, the curses and sworn judgment written in the law of Moses, the servant of God, have been poured out on us because we have sinned against you. Daniel was saying and repenting and asking God for forgiveness. For the people of God have sinned against him, broken the covenant. So that's the content, that's the focus of verses 4 to 14. Daniel talks about that on and on and on. Because why? They broke the covenant. Now, if you may be wondering, what is a covenant? What is a covenant? A covenant is basically like a contract in modern days term, a contract between two parties where they agree that, for example, this party and this party, both parties will do whatever they agree on. And should they agree to do whatever they have signed, this will be a list of blessings that both sides will get. And this will be the curses should anyone not fulfill their end of the covenant. So that's basically what a covenant was. And God made a covenant with his people in Deuteronomy. And so when Daniel said this, the curses and sworn judgment written in the law of Moses, he was bringing to mind the covenant that God made with his people. And he come before God and say, we have sinned. We have fallen away from you. And this is the reason why we are in exile. So that's the context of why Daniel said this in verse 11. Now, I put this up for you, not for you to read all of it. There's too much to read. But what I want to highlight for us to take note of is the things in orange. The things in orange. I have done us the liberty to highlight the things in orange just to show you the focus of Daniel's prayer in the first part. Over here, you'll see in orange, sin and done wrong, turn away from your commands, unfaithful to you, rebel against him, refusing to obey you. So you see that Daniel's theme in his first part of his prayer is one that describes the people's disobedience, unfaithfulness. And essentially what Daniel is doing here is he's coming before God and repenting. He's saying, God, we are so sorry for what we have done. We seek and ask for your forgiveness. That, in essence, is a posture of repentance that we see in the first part of Daniel's prayer. You can take a picture later and then you can highlight in your Bible later at home. But the idea of how the people of God have sinned is not something that is a problem that of Daniel's time. The Apostle Paul in Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." It's not a problem of the Old Testament. It's a human problem. It's a human problem. Turn to someone next to you and say, "It's you and I. It's you and I. All have sinned." No one is left out in this equation. As long as we are here on this earth, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Charles Spurgeon, the great Puritan, who said this, he says, "Repentance is a hatred of sin. It is a turning from sin and a determination in the strength of God to forsake it." Turning away. Repentance, in essence, is metanoia in the Greek. It's the idea of making a conscious decision to turn away. It's a change of mindset. That's exactly what repentance is. And we see what Daniel is doing here. He is coming before God in asking for forgiveness, but an active decision to say, I choose to turn away from my waywardness and I choose to look towards you, God. In response. Again, I'll show this slide again. Why? Because if you look again in the ones in yellow, I highlighted the things in yellow. Daniel didn't say, they have done wrong. They have not listened to you. They have disobeyed and sinned against you. No, Daniel included himself. He included himself. He said, we have been wicked. We have turned away from your commands. We have not listened. Daniel sought repentance not for the people, but he sought the repentance for him as well. Daniel didn't separate himself and say, they have sinned. Daniel included himself. He says, we have sinned. All of us. Now, it's significant. Why? Because Daniel is regarded in the Old Testament as someone who is a righteous man. In Ezekiel 14, I don't know about you, but if your name is in the Bible and you're said to be a righteous man, I'm pretty sure you are a righteous man. In Ezekiel 14:14, that's why he says, Daniel was one of the three people listed to be a righteous man before God. But yet you see here in Daniel's character, Daniel associated himself as one who is also unrighteous. The first thing that we learn from Daniel's prayer is this, that the repentance of our nature is essential as we try to pray through the storms in life. To try to recognize it's not just about they who have made a mistake, but we as well, we have a part to play in the sins that the people of God have committed. And so that's something that we can learn from Daniel. Instead of pointing fingers at others, we ourselves, we are also sinful beings. Likewise. That's why Paul in 1 Corinthians 12:26 says, if one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. And I know in the recent years, I don't know whether you are aware, but in the recent years, the Christian community around the world have been bugged, have been stained by many of our very prominent Christian leaders falling, either by different kinds of sin, moral failings. And it's been something that has been prevalent in the recent years. And you know, I was studying in the US for my in seminary before I came on full time. And in my time, in my 5 years in the US while I was studying, there were 4 prominent Christian leaders that fell. During the time I was studying, every single year, one after another. And the reason why it affected me so much, because 3 of them out of the 4, 3 of them were alumni and people who used to study in my seminary. And I was so affected. I was like, what is going on? Every single year, one after the other. First was Bill Hybels from Willow Creek Community Church. the founder of the mega church model. The next was James McDonald. James McDonald, one of the fastest growing church in the world. The other one, of course, many of you will know, Ravi Zacharias. Ravi Zacharias, a great apologist. Three of them who studied in my school, whom I looked up to as role models, all fell. And I was really affected by it when I was studying there. And so I went before God and asked, why, God, why would you allow these things to happen? Because it doesn't just affect the people, the leaders, but they also affect everyone in the Christian community and those who are not Christian. They say, see, you talk so much about sin, you talk so much about sexual purity, but look at you. Look at your leaders. And I went before God and I said, why, God, why would you allow this? And then as I prayed, the scriptures came to mind. That as we continue to live out our faith as disciples of Jesus, whether we are a leader or not, what we do outside matters. Because that's how people will view the faith, the Christian faith. And so what we do matters. Turn to someone next to you and say, what you do matters. And so if one member suffer, all suffer together. And that's the reason why it's important that as we pray that we will be anchored through the storm, through prayer. One of the first things we need to do in our prayer is that we need to repent. Repent of our sins, of our nature of one who is sinful to begin with. That's the first thing that we come to learn. You know, Brian Chappell said this. Brian Chappell is the former president of Covenant Theological Seminary. This is what he says. Why should we confess and petition and live for the sake of others? This is what he says. The answer is that not only is confession not just about me, not only is petition not just about me. Ultimately, we discern from the prayers and life of Daniel that salvation is not just about me. It's not just about you. God just didn't save you alone. He came to redeem and save the entire world. And so as we walk out our discipleship journey, our Christian walk, it's not just you and God, because God is coming to receive and redeem a people. People means more than one person, correct? And that's the reason why as we think through our lives, we don't just pray for ourselves. We need to pray for others as well. That's why I'm so glad that in St. Andrews, you guys pray for different ones in your church, right? Because that's a way of keeping the reminder that salvation is not just about me. And so that's the first thing that we come to learn from Daniel in his prayer. Repentance of our nature. But the second ingredient to pray through the storm is the reliance on His nature. Not just the repentance of our nature, but the reliance on His nature. More than just confessing our sins, more than just saying we turn away from our sins, Daniel then moves his attention in his prayer from verse 15 to 19, that our focus now is turning away from our sin and turning towards God. If you look with me closely now from verse 15 to 19, you will see this. Again, you don't have to read everything. But if you see the things highlighted in blue, Daniel appeals to God and tells God, we are your people in keeping with all your righteous acts, your anger, your wrath from Jerusalem, your holy hill, your city. Daniel was appealing from talking about we. Now he says, your people, your name, your righteous acts. Daniel was bringing to mind the faithfulness of God in keeping His end of the covenant. It's not so much about what the people can do, but what He can do. That's why in Daniel, for example, here, we see that Daniel appealing to the covenant. Why? For example, in Daniel 9, verse 4, I highlighted the words in white to show you that he is bringing to mind in his prayer the scripture in Deuteronomy 7, 9. He's talking about the God who keeps His covenant. Essentially, the God who is faithful. That's the character of who God is. A God who is faithful amongst other aspects of who God is. God is faithful. He said, God who is faithful. That's the character of God. And when we go back to here, in Daniel chapter 9, verse 18, we see that Daniel says, "We do not make request of you because we are righteous, but because of your great mercy." Daniel was appealing to the faithfulness of God in the midst of the sins of his people and him. And so as we pray through the storms in life, whether it be work-related, home-related, health-related, we come before God, essentially, most importantly, as we look towards Him, as we pray and remember God's character, one who is faithful, one is good, one who loves you more than anything in the world. Amen? Because that's the character of God. We may fail, but God will never, because His character never changes. You know, sometimes in life, it reminds me of like a VR set. Some of y'all know what a VR set is for some of you here? A VR set is where you put on and then you enter a different world. It's like you're living in a completely different world with the goggles. Sometimes in life, it's like living with goggles on. We go about in our world with goggles on. We think this is the world. This is it. And sometimes in life, when storms hit us, we're like, oh my gosh, what to do? I'm lost. I don't know whether you saw funny videos of people wearing VR, then they hit their head on the wall sometimes because they think that's the reality. But the moment, my friends, when we choose to repent of our nature and rely on His nature, what happens is that we begin to remove the goggles. We remove the goggles and we begin to see reality for what it truly is. That the storms in life will not overcome us because we have a God who is all-knowing, all-sovereign, all-loving, and all-faithful. Amen? And that's something we need to do as we encounter the storms in life. We pray through the storms because those storms will pass and our God will still be there. And so as you continue in your walk with God, remember this picture of the goggles. By praying, you're removing the goggles. What the world tells you is important. What the world tells you is what you need in life. You remove the goggles when you start praying, when you start reading the scriptures. That's what happens when we pray through the storm. I'm going to come to a close very soon, but one practical question we have to ask ourselves is, so what does it look like for us to pray then? I want us all to take out our right hand. Everyone with your right hand, can you lift up high? Wonderful. I like to use this prayer hand. We use that quite often in our church. The hand, you can put your hands down. The right hand is basically left hand, can be used as a way to guide you in praying. The prayer hand, so that we don't just pray for ourselves, we pray for those around us as well. So for example, the thumb, you start with thanking God for God's goodness, thanksgiving for God's goodness. Why? Because God is good all the time and all the time. Yes, so we start with this. We start with thanksgiving of Him in our lives and those around us. And then following is leaders and authorities over us, your leaders in this land, in church, in Brunei. You pray for the leaders in authority. Why? Because usually when you point, is talking about leadership. Okay? Number three, the middle finger is the significant people in our lives, those who are closest and most important to you, the tallest finger on your hand. Number four, your ring finger are those who are weak, sick, marginalized in our society. And then finally, the last and the smallest one on your hand is your little pinky finger, which you pray for yourself. So I want to encourage you as you go forth from here, not just to hear about what Daniel prayed for. Truth alone doesn't change life. Truth applied changes lives. And so we want to apply the scriptures as we leave this morning. This is a good example for you to practice this. Maybe you want to do it every single day. Maybe you can start with once a week, having this habit to pray not just for yourself. So I want to leave this with you as an example that you can consider including into your prayer life. I want to close this morning with a simple story. A simple story of someone whom I got to meet. So one of the things that I do back home in my home church before I step into this new role was that I was leading our youth. And one of the things I focus on amongst our youth is leadership development. And so we hold a camp called Generations Camp every year. And then I'll get a group of lay youth leaders, youth themselves, 17, 18-year-old, to lead and plan for the camp. And at this camp that we had last year for our youths, there was this guy that was brought by his friend. It's the picture on your left. And his name is Dimitri. He's not a believer. He's a free thinker. He was brought by a friend to the camp. And during after the first night of worship and the sermon, he suddenly collapsed. And the group around him didn't know what to do. And they thought he collapsed because he no oxygen or something. So they quickly called me from the stage, and I went down after the service ended, and I went to check on him. And I quickly said, okay, go and find a nurse or a doctor to come in to check on him. And while they did that, I went and looked at him, and I look and ask, he's okay, he's breathing. He seems to be breathing. He looks like he's sleeping, but he's not, because he was frowning. So the Spirit of God impressed upon me, could you go to him and could you say the word Jesus? So I went to him. I said, Dimitri, can you try to say the word Jesus? And so while he was kind of like eyes closed but conscious, he was like, G-g-g-g-g. And he tried several times, like, G-g-g-g-g. And the more he tried to say the word, the next moment, he found himself waking up. And he turned around, and there was some unclean spirit in him that started to act up. And we had like five people to press him down. As you can see, he's quite tall and big. So we got five people to press him down, and there was screaming happening at the top of his lungs. And I said, Dimitri, try to say Jesus once more. He's like, gee. And then again, there was a manifestation of the spirit, of unclean spirit. And I was like, ah. And we kept praying for him. We prayed against and tried to cast out whatever unclean spirit that was in him. But after a while, we prayed. It got better for a while. And then it continued again. And then one of the fellow pastors that was with me, she said, have you ever confessed your sins? Have you ever confessed your sins and made Jesus the Lord of your life? And of course, the answer is no, because he's not a believer. And so we got him to say, Dimitri, can you confess your sins? He said, Lord, would you forgive me of my sins? I invite you in my life as my Lord and Savior. And so Dimitri, in a state of all these different things, he managed to say that. He's like, would you forgive me? And I make you the Lord of my life. The moment he said that, all that stopped. The Spirit left him. And he was himself again. I share that with you this morning to simply show us that there's a spiritual world that we live in. But more than that, the need for confession of our sins is real. It's not something that's just said in the Bible for the sake of it. The confession of our sins to God is a way of submitting ourselves to the Lordship of Christ. And when we say the name Jesus, there is power in breaking whatever bondages that we struggle with, whatever insecurities, whatever fears we have. That's the power of God. It's not something that's just written in the Word alone, but the Word of God is living and active among us. Amen? And so as we come to a close this morning, I've listed a few names of God. Because previously in this text, in Daniel chapter 9, we see that Daniel appealed to God. He says, for your name, for your sake, and the people who bear your name. This morning, as you look at the different names of God, I don't know what situations and circumstances that you have in your life. Some of you are going through a storm. Some of you are about to go into the storm. This morning, I want you to look at the list of names. There are many more, but these are some of the names I listed. Whether it be a health condition, whether it be an unforeseen circumstance that have happened in your life, I want you to look at the names of God as a way for you to remember the God that you worship, The same God that Daniel worshipped in the Old Testament is the same God that we worship now, right now, as New Testament believers. El Shaddai, El Olam, Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Rohi, Emmanuel, and Jesus, the name above all names, the Apostle Paul says in Philippians 2. The name which at the name of Jesus, every tongue, every tribe shall bow at His feet and confess that Jesus is Lord. And so as you look at the different names, and as you look at and reflect upon your own life, in your own circumstance right now, I want you to pray. Pray the name of God over the circumstance that you are facing in life, whether it be a health situation, whether it be fear of leaving the world. You pray and you bring to mind who God is, because the character of God doesn't change. And so that's something I want to leave with us this morning, that as you declare that Jesus is Lord, I want you to declare it not in the sense of just singing songs, but it's a way of saying, I choose to trust that Jesus and God will indeed be my anchor through the storm. Let us pray. Father, we give thanks and praise for what you have done for us. Though we are undeserving, though we have constantly and consistently not kept our end of following you faithfully, you continue to pursue us all the days of our lives. And so we come before you. We ask for your forgiveness for the times that we have not walked in your ways, for the times that we have chose to trust in ourselves, in things of this world instead of you. We repent of that. And God, we look to you this morning. We choose to rely on your nature, your faithful character that doesn't change. And God, we desire to cling on to who you are, the God who provides, the God who is faithful, the God who is our shepherd, the God who sees, the God who provides. Lord, would you speak your truth, your character into the situations present in this room, that in Jesus' name, that there will be faith, there will be confidence, there will be a sense of being anchored through the storms in life for all of the days that we live on earth, because we choose to trust you and you alone. We give you praise and all the honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Can I invite you all to stand? We say the Nicene Creed together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us men and for our salvation. He came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate of the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated.
Amen indeed.
Good morning, church. Wow, thank you, Pastor Timothy, for sharing the word of God, reminding us that, yes, we must remember our nature. And because of that, we need to repent. And then, of course, focus on God. because he I'm just gobsmacked, just reminding about who God is, you know. Remove the goggles. Goggles sometimes can detract us from the reality of life, and you know, we put ourselves into our own reality, thinking that we are good, but actually we are not good, you know. And that's what it should be. When we know we are not good, we reach out to the one that we know who is always good. Yeah. So thank you, my brother. Thank you. He will also be sharing at E2 this morning, and then he goes back this evening. So thank you for your visit. I'm sure there may be future visits also. Okay. This morning we also want to welcome back Peter Chai. Can you stand, Peter? Lorna and Mary's brother. Yeah. Okay. And then we also got Dr. Wima Thomas. Ah, there we are. And of course, Dr. Thomas Abraham Jacob. Ah, okay. Welcome. I'm sure there are a few others who are here. Okay, so let's welcome one another later also in our when we share a handshake or a fist bump or a, what do you call this? Elbow. Yeah, elbow bump, okay? Now, it's all funny ways of sharing peace. Some notices for our attention this morning. First and foremost, our school is having a family fun day. Okay, basically the PTA, the new PTA is organizing a family fun day. So I encourage you to be part of that. That's from 2 o'clock to 6 p.m. Quite a number of stalls, quite a number of booths. It's supposed to be a time where students, families will come, but also the general public can drop in also. So I encourage you to join in. And then also, it's also, I think they are also fundraising, okay? So that's also all for a good cause. You know, in Brunei, we need to do the good things, you know, not just do it for ourselves, okay? So that's an occasion to drop by 2 to 6 this afternoon. Please join us for our prayer meeting, okay? We didn't ask Timothy to raise that up, but I think it's a wonderful reminder that, you know, we need to pray. Prayer was Daniel's first resort upon the news, but reminded his regular habit also. And not just on his own, you know. I'm sure as people of God, we pray, but praying together also has useful dynamics for us, okay? And then, of course, next Friday, the Pastors Fellowship is organizing the Prayer for Christian Unity. So that's happening in the Catholic Church, Kola. They are hosting it. We will host the one in July, but this is actually quite delayed, okay? But nevertheless, it's good when the people of God come together. You know, Psalm 133, you know, where it says God will command a blessing. You know, I love that psalm, you know. It says God will command a blessing. And that's what we want, a blessing from the Lord, okay? So, yeah, blessing, the next one, please. A seminar is being planned on the 14th of March. We have a guest speaker coming in, okay? Blessing and engaging our neighbor. We are quite a minority in Brunei. You probably know this, right? So how do we engage our majority? How do we engage our neighbor? And this is part of that agenda, okay? So it's going to be a combined care group meeting, but also a special meeting to all. So we encourage you to be part of that, okay? So book that night, 14th of March, the Thursday night. And advance warning on Friday, the 22nd of March. Okay, I know we've done this a while ago. We haven't done it recently, but we want to resume the blood donation campaign. Okay, so the joke now is St. Andrews don't want just your money and your time, your attendance. We want your blood. But, you know, I mean, it's a useful cause, right? Fasting month, typically the Muslim, they don't give, you know, and has responsible citizens and residents, this is our responsibility, you know. I don't need to say anymore. It's our responsibility and our privilege to be able to give blood for a good cause, okay? So that's happening on in the morning, okay, the Friday before Palm Sunday. And then, of course, in the afternoon is our annual Gotong Royong and Palm Cross Making. So please book that 22nd. Okay, I'm sure your bosses will allow you to give blood, right? And then after that, you can take the day off. No. Yeah, but I think it's a good cause. So please consider that. Please give. Please come along. Let's be a blessing to this nation. Let's be a blessing to our neighbors. Okay. And then advance notice on the Holy Week, 28, 29, 30, and 31st. Okay. There are a few other activities going on, but at the church level, this is what's happening. At 6:15 service on Monday, Thursday, Holy Communion service, where we also strip the altar. Okay. Good Friday is evening prayer, but before that, we have a movie screening, The Passion of the Christ, and then service at 6:15. And then we have a seminar. We have a seminar on the crucified life. Useful to, again, remember what the Lord did for us. He calls us to follow him. What does that mean? What does that mean to give up ourselves, deny ourselves, take up our cross and follow him? And then Easter Vigil basically, Easter Vigil is quite a highlight for us, our church calendar. So service at 7:30. Okay, and then Easter Sunday will be 9 a.m., followed by bring and share brunch together. Yeah, okay, so we will start beginning to remind you of this schedule for ourselves, a good time to celebrate. Camp, it's camp time because school holiday is coming up. Okay, this year our school wants to go to Miri to do their camp. Okay, and because you're in Miri, other people also want to jalan, tumpang with us. So that's what's happening on the 7 to 9, which is a Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. Okay, immediately after, if you notice, last week we talked about Deacon Martin's ordination. It is confirmed on the 6th of April now. We will announce it more formally next week. Okay, so following the ordination, the next day there will be this camp happening. So that's for our cool. Okay, and anybody else is going to come along. And then, of course, our youth also are having a camp, and they have a video. So let's watch that video.
2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. His divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of him who called us by his glory and goodness.
Through these, he has given us his very great precious promises, so that through them, you may participate in the divine nature, having escaped the corruption in the world caused by evil desires.
For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness, knowledge, and to knowledge, self-control, and to self-control, perseverance, and to perseverance, godliness.
And to godliness, mutual affection, and to mutual affection, love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ.
But whoever does not have them is nearsighted and blind, forgetting that they have been cleansed from their past sins.
Therefore, my brothers and sisters, make every effort to confirm your calling and election. For if you do these things, you will never stumble, and you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
God provided us with everything. He is a power that never runs out. With the resources he gives us, we are able to grow with virtues in our lives. Though as believers, we struggle with sin and imperfection. And the scripture reminds us that God has given us everything we need to grow. Perfection is not needed, but staying close to Jesus and exercising Christ's attributes daily is a need. It is our duty as followers of Christ to continue to gain the knowledge of the Word and reaching out to those who do not know God personally.
The Apostle Peter, you know, he said, we've been given everything already, you know, through God's glory and through his grace as well. We've been given everything. And for me, that says that there's no excuse for us to be continually living our lives in sin. There's just no excuse. We've been given everything. We have been equipped with God's word, that is Jesus. There's also that idea where as Christians, we also have to do certain works. We still have to do effort in our parts in working on these seven virtues that Peter has said, the goodness, perseverance, the self-control, even after we're saved. So we're doing these works because we've already received salvation, you know. Verse 10 mentions that we have to confirm our election. So it's confirmed that we are we're already chosen by God. So therefore, we have to do the works to live godly lives.
We are called for the
excellence of God, the virtuous God.
Okay, that's the promo for our youth camp. The kids' camp, our cool camp, and our YDM camp are very important events for our church. You know, so if you know children, okay, kidnap them for those 7 to 9, 9 to 12, pay them to come, buy them, you know, bribe them to come, you know, that kind of thing. But I think it's very helpful. You know, I when I was listening to the youth promo, you know, I got goosebumps when young people begin to read the Word of God and preach the Word of God. Wow, be high. I like that. I think we need more of that. Yeah, older folks, you also can do the same. We're going to have an older folks camp. Okay, please, right? We're going to get you to be on video and you can do the same, okay? I think this is about learning about God and knowing more about Him so that we can do the things that He wants us to do. Amen? And you say amen, but wait, older folks camp coming up. You better sign up. Nanin Chako, please, don't diam-diam sana, Nanin Chako, okay? Okay, with that, let me invite Witsi to come and lead us in intercession. Let us pray.
The Lord has invited us here today to be in His presence and to feel His presence. So let's close our eyes and offer ourselves to the presence of Jesus. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we come before You today to praise, worship, and give You thanks. Father God, You promised to hear us through Your Son, Jesus Christ, when we pray in faith. Your mercy is new every morning. You are the God who can do all things. You reign over all. Power and might are in Your hands. Let's pray for the world and for peace. O Lord, send Your Spirit into the hearts of all men, that the world might know true peace through Your abundant mercy. Let love and forgiveness reign in the hearts of all. Let Your peace surpass all understanding and keep all the earth in Christ Jesus. Lord, in Your mercy, hear our prayer. Let's pray for the Christian churches the world over. Father God, we pray for our diocese, St. Andrew's Church, and other churches in Brunei. Loving Father, we plead for the diocese. We plead for our bishops, our pastoral staff, and thank You for blessing this church with such an able and compassionate leadership. And we pray for Your continuous mercy to be upon them and guide them in their paths of service, that they continue to serve You in holiness and in good faith. Lord, in Your mercy, hear our prayers. Gracious God, You are the source of all life and blessings and the giver of every grace. We thank You for the word of God we heard today morning. Let us understand the importance of prayer and let Your word touch the inner core of our being and bring healing to our ailing bodies. May the seeds of Your word be sprouting and bearing fruits in our own lives. Father, we pray for Brunei, where we live, and thank You for its peace and prosperity. We pray for His Majesty, the Sultan of Brunei, His Council of Ministers, and all in power and in key positions. Grant them wisdom and understanding so they can make the best decisions to serve this nation. Loving God, we pray for families and our neighbors. May You strengthen every family in this community. We pray for peace, love, unity and trust within our homes. May Your Holy Spirit prevail over each one of us in our homes. Please give us faith and wisdom to remain strong and united during phases of sickness and challenges in our life. Lord, in your mercy. Father God, we entrust all our friends in your care, and for those who have not yet accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, we pray that you may touch their hearts and convict them of their sins, so that they may come to the knowledge of your Holy Son, Jesus Christ. Father, we pray for your children around the world who are vulnerable, suffering mistreatment and threats of death for their allegiance to you. Let them keep alive their joy in your creation through Christ Jesus, our Lord. Lord, in your mercy. Father God, we pray for the sick and needy people all over the world. We pray that you will be the one who will be touching them, and we remember before you all the homeless and destitute who are our brethren, and show us how to be a part of their lives by giving our time, prayers, and resources during this Lent season, Lord. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful God, we pray for the Christian missionaries all over the world who are going through hard times, those who are faced with persecution. Father God, preserve them and keep them safe to preach the gospel to all nations. Rejoicing in the fellowship of St. Andrew's and all your saints, we commend ourselves and all Christian people to your unfailing love. Together we pray,
Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
We continue with a prayer of humble access. Let us say it together. Most merciful Lord, your love compels us to come in. Our hands are unclean, our hearts unprepared. We were not fit even to eat the crumbs up under your table. But you, Lord, are the God of our salvation, and share your bread with sinners. So cleanse and feed us with the precious body and blood of your Son, that he may live in us and we in him, that we, with the whole company of Christ, may sit and eat in your kingdom. Amen. We rise for the peace. My brothers and sisters, we are the body of Christ. In the one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
We remain standing to sing the offertory hymn, Be Thou My Vision.
Oh, let us say the thanksgiving together. Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendor, and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you, and of your own do we give you. We will use the first Eucharistic prayer. My brothers and sisters, the Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Yes, it is indeed right. It is our duty and our joy at all times and all places to give you thanks and praise, Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord. For he is your living word. Through him you have created all things from the beginning and formed us in your own image. Through him you have freed us from the slavery of sin, giving him to be born as man and to die upon the cross. You raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand on high. Through him you have sent upon us your holy and life-giving spirit and made us a people for your own possession. And now we give you thanks because in his coming as man, the day of our deliverance has dawned, and through him you will make all things new as he comes in power and triumph to judge the world. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Please be seated. Accept our praises, Heavenly Father, through your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and as we follow his example and obey his command, grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, this gift of bread and wine may be to us his body and his blood. On the same night that I was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross and proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. As we look for his coming in glory, we celebrate with this bread and this cup his one perfect sacrifice. Accept through him our great high priest. This is our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your spirit, inspire us with your love, and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Together, through him and with him and in him, by the power of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honor and glory and power be yours forever. as our Savior Jesus taught us, so we pray.
Heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
My brothers and sisters, we break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, give us your peace.
My brothers and sisters, draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Let us pray. The post-communion collect, let us do it together. Merciful Lord, grant your people grace to withstand the temptations of the world, the flesh, and the devil, and with pure hearts and minds to follow you, the only God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brother's home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you set before us, so we and all our children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We say the thanksgiving together. Almighty God, thank you for feeding us, body and blood of his Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Let me invite you to rise for the blessing from God. My brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ, the Son of Righteousness, shine upon you and your family and scatter the darkness from before your path, and the blessing of the Lord God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Now go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Amen.
Amen indeed.
Lord God, we thank you for this morning as we reflect your word, that repentance is a fragrance worship to you. Therefore, O Lord, we pray, we thank you for your mercy, and we pray that you bless the worship and the services that will be going on till this evening. Let our repentance be a fragrance to you. And most of all, bless us with your presence as we go joyfully on our ways. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.